God bless you, loved ones. Welcome to the Word with Chester. Today we'll continue study in the second chapter of the book of 1 Peter. In our last setting, we read down to verse 12. Today we will reread verse 12 and continue to the conclusion of this chapter. I do appreciate all of you for logging on and watching this ministry. I thank God for you. I have no idea how many people are watching, but I do know the numbers that I see have increased greatly since we started this ministry. And I want you to know that I thank you so very, very much, because I know your time is valuable. And when you take the time to log on and click onto this ministry, it's a blessing to me. I want you to know that I love you with the love of the Lord. I ask that you continue to pray for me and pray for this ministry, that God will get the glory and take us to heights that we have never seen before. I believe God, and I know He has His hand on this ministry, and with your prayers, we can reach the mastery. Well, shall we reread verse 12 and then continue? Verse 12 reads, "Having your behavior honest among the Gentiles, that whereas they speak against you as evildoers, they may, by your good works, which they shall behold, glorify God in the day of visitation." Well, this is such an important verse, and how a Christian should be. We should walk honestly. That should be one thing that's a given. If you're a Christian or a child of the King, you ought to be honest about everything you do, honest in how you treat people, honest in your business dealings downtown, and honest on your job by giving them an honest day's work for what they pay you. Honest in every area of life. And this is a sign of a Christian that he has the Lord in his heart, when he can just be honest. Number one, honest with yourself. Honest with your own shortcomings, and know where you need to grow. All of that has to do with honesty, and we should reach that point that we are honest. And this writer put emphasis on honest among the Gentiles. In other words, the folks that don't believe like you. The folks that have not heard the word of God all of their life. You got to understand, you have an example of a Christian to be a light before them. I'm going to read 12 again and continue. "Having your behavior honest among the Gentiles, that whereas they speak against you as evildoers, that they may by your good works, which they have behold, glorify God in the day of visitation." When the Holy Spirit deals with them, when He visits them, they ought to can say, I saw that brother how he lived. I saw that sister how she lived, and want to be like that. You can draw them, believe me, and you can drive them away. So you have to watch what you do. Well, verse 13 reads, "Submit yourself to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake, whether it be to the king as supreme." What is he saying? He's telling you to obey the laws of the land. If it's in the the laws of the land tells you not to do something, you're not a good testimony when you break that law and go ahead and do it anyway. Well, that's all the writer's saying. Now, I know there's different countries with different laws. There's different cultures with different ways of doing things, but you got to understand, if you're in a culture or in a country where the law tells you not to do it, and you do it anyway, they see you as a lawbreaker. So this writer is saying, if you name the name of Christ, submit yourself to the ordinances of man for the Lord's sake, whether it be the king as supreme. Shall we read verse 14? "Or unto governors as unto them that are sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and for the praise of them that do well." What is he saying? Those that uphold the law, from the king all the way down. In the United States of America, we don't have a king, but we have a president. Well, we should hold him in high esteem, and the laws that stem down from his office, we ought to abide by them and be an example to the world, to the others that see that this is what we're supposed to do. If you name the name of Christ, well, shall we read verse 15? "For so is the will of God, that with well-doing ye may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men." Just because cause you to do right. You can put to silence those that talk evil against the kingdom of God, who talk nonsense about the kingdom of God. Just by you doing right, you can lift up a standard and put them to silence. All those foolish men who do not reverence and hold God in high esteem. Let's continue to read. As free and not using your liberty for a cloak of maliciousness, but as the servant of God. What is he talking about there? Very deep verse. As free. We are free. We're not under the bondage of the law and not using your liberty for a cloak of maliciousness. What do you mean? We are free. God has set us free. We're not under the yoke of the law. But let me put it this way. Just because you have liberty and you're not under the law, that don't mean you ought to be malicious with what you're doing. I'll just use a hypothetical here, and I'm not speaking up for or against what I'm talking about. Here's a group of people. They don't believe that a person's supposed to drink wine, but you have a liberty that you think it's all right for you to drink wine, and you're going to use that as a malicious tool or as some type of device to get over on them. I try to show them that I can do what I want to do. Don't you know your attitude has gotten wrong? What you do may not be terribly wrong, but your attitude has gotten wrong. That's what made you wrong. Not the drinking of a glass of wine, but you gotta put it all up in their face and say, oh, I can do what I want to. I'm 3 times 7. I'm 21. I can drink this. I can do this. I can do that. You gotta understand, that's a malicious way of using your liberty. So what is the writer saying? That we ought to not just because we have the right to do something, just because we can do something, or we're not condemned in doing something, that doesn't mean that we have to use it to hit people over the head with. And that's the same way vice versa. You don't drink, so you're going to beat up everybody that have a glass of wine. Or you do have a glass of wine, you want to beat up everybody that don't drink a glass of wine. I hope you're understanding what I'm saying. I'm not stating a case for, nor am I stating a case against. I'm saying don't use your liberty if you're free as a malicious as maliciousness, a cloak of maliciousness, a covering of maliciousness, but as a servant of God. Everything you do should be as you are a servant of God. Verse 17 says, honor all men, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the king. Do I need to read that again? Honor all men. ALL means all. Not just because you got money. It's easy for us to honor folks that's got a great deal of money and they roll in a Bentley or Rolls Royce. We want to give them honor. But the same man that drives in a Ford, he's got just as much Holy Ghost as the one would have that's driving a fine car, a lot of money. So this writer saying, honor all men. We shouldn't stereotype people and say, well, this one's right because he has. This one wrong because he does not have. And then you can put it vice versa. The poor folks want to say that the rich folks ain't going to heaven. And the rich folks want to say that the poor folks, they don't have God because, look, they ain't got nothing. All of that mentality is wrong. We should love everyone and honor all men, regardless if he's on the same status as you, regardless if you have more money than he or you have less money than he. You should honor all men. Love the brotherhood. You got to understand, we're supposed to be putting our arms around each other and not talking and being against one another. Fear God and honor the king. There's that word is again, honor the king. Number one, we honor God, but yet those in authority. I told you in the United States of America, we have a president, and many nations have a president. What is he saying? Honor that president. Honor that leader. I can't get with you. I don't care if you're on the opposing side of the president. I can't get with you lashing out at him in public and saying demeaning things about him in public. Well, if you were my senator, my congressman, whatever you are, you'd never get my vote again. Why? Because you got the audacity to lash out at our president in a public forum. Well, what you and him say behind closed doors, I ain't got nothing to do with that. But when you let everybody in the world see that you got a problem or you got an attitude with the president, you got the problem, and you'll never get my vote. Well, let me read on. In verse 18, it reads, "Servant, be subject to your masters with all fear. Be subject to your masters with all fear, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the perverse." What do you mean? If you have a master, or let's just put it this way, let's bring it down to today's term. If you got a boss man, the word of God here is saying, be subject to your master with all fear. And I'm not going into the day that this writer wrote this book. There was slavery at the time. So we have to, if we want to be biblically correct, we have to encompass this. But in the day that we live in the United States of America, we don't have slaves, or we should not have slaves. But we do have people in authority over us. You have somebody that you work under, and not only that, if you're a businessman, you have those in authority over you that the health department, if you please, or whatever entity it is, OSHA, all of these type of things. The word of God is saying, be subject to your master with all fear, and not only to the good and gentle, but also to the perverse. What are you saying? Well, there's some good people, some good bosses. There's some good supervisors. But let me let you know, there's also some rotten eggs. But this writer is saying, be subject to him if he's a good supervisor, but also be subject if he's perverse. If he's a rotten egg, as long as he has that authority, be subject to him. Why? Because he has that authority. But I also let you know, you can pray about it. Tell your main boss, tell God about it. And if he's that terrible, God knows how to get him out the way. Well, let's read in verse 19. "For this is thankworthy if a man for conscience toward God endure grief, suffering wrong." Thankworthy. This is thankworthy. Thank what? Thank God, number one. This is thankworthy if a man for conscience toward God endure grief. Well, what do you mean? Just because somebody mess with you, that don't give you the right to pull out your 45 and blow them away. Well, do I need to read that again? Verse 19. "For this is thankworthy if a man for conscience toward God endure grief, suffering wrong." It's a good thing. Everybody's not going to be right. You got to get that in your heart and in your mind and in your spirit. There's going to be always somebody doing wrong. But if you learn how to endure that hardness, endure that grief, don't you know God will smile on you? Well, let's read verse 20 and continue. "For what glory is it if when ye are buffeted for your faults, ye shall take it patiently? But if when ye do well and suffer for it, ye take it patiently, this is acceptable with God." What is he talking about? Well, when you do the wrong thing, there's repercussions behind it. Some things may follow. All the writer's saying, if you've done wrong, you got to take it patiently. But he also turned the coin. Even if you haven't did any wrong and you suffer things, your name is ostracized, or you criticized unjustly, if you haven't been treated right, well, still take it patiently. That don't give you the right, if you know you haven't did what they said, to go completely off the wall and off the chain, whatever you want to call it. You better understand that you have a God to serve. I got to read 20 again. "For what glory is it if when ye are buffeted for your fault?" What glory is it when you're buffeted because of the things you've done, ye shall take it patiently? At the latter part of that verse, "But if when ye do well and suffer for it, ye take it patiently. this is acceptable with God. Don't you know God is pleased with you when you can take even those that have wronged you, take the situation patiently and watch God be a blessing to you. Well, shall we read in verse 21? For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that ye should follow his steps. What do you mean? He suffered more than you can ever think about suffering. Well, that's what we call suffering. So what if somebody talks about you? So what if somebody misunderstands you? So what if somebody get the picture wrong and run all downtown with the wrong thing? So what? That's not suffering. But let me let you know, when they start laying hands on you and whipping you with a whip, you got to understand, and nailing you to the cross, then you can talk about suffering. What Jesus suffered, he suffered more than any man has. He suffered, he bled, and he died for your sins and mine. But I thank God he didn't stay dead. He was resurrected, and that's the word of the Lord in verse 22. Who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth. All of the suffering he went through, it wasn't because he sinned. It wasn't because he did anything wrong. It wasn't because he had guile in his mouth. It was because the men that were persecuting him, they had the problem. But Jesus suffered, having did no sin. Well, let's read on in 23. Who, when he was reviled, reviled not again. When he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself to him that judges righteously. Do I need to read that again? Who, when he was reviled, who we're talking about? When Jesus was reviled, reviled not again. He didn't retaliate like the generation we have in today's world. He didn't retaliate because somebody got on his nerve or because somebody hurt him. He didn't do a drive-by because somebody hurt his own. You got to understand, we need to get away from that. We need to learn how to let God fight our battles. Who, when he was reviled, reviled not again. When he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself to him that judges righteously. He committed himself to his own Father. Well, verse 24 reads, who his own self bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead in sin, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. I read that a little rough, so I guess I'm going to read it again in a little bit. But he's talking about the suffering of our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ. He's talking about what Jesus did for you on Calvary. He's talking about the suffering. Every drop of blood that was shed, he's talking about it in this verse, letting you know who his own self bore our sins. He bore our sins, not because he sinned was he on the cross, but because you sinned, because humankind, mankind sinned. So he bore our sin in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sin, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. By the stripes on his back, you are healed. He was bruised for our transgression, wounded for our transgression, bruised for our iniquity. The chastisement of our peace is upon him, and with his stripes, we are healed. And that's the word of the Lord. In verse 25, for ye were as sheep going astray, but are now returned unto the shepherd and bishop of the soul. Oh, Jesus came. You got to understand, you were as sheep going astray. Not only, let me let you know, let me bring it down. Not only the Jewish folks at that time, they were going astray. They were going astray and thought they were doing right. But Jesus came. You got to get it now. But Jesus came, but are now returned unto the shepherd and bishop of the soul. When Jesus came, he gave you a light to come back to yourself. He gave you a light to come back to the shepherd, the bishop of the soul. And that word bishop means overseer. Our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ, I dare you to come to him. Let him be the bishop of your soul, of the overseer. him and watch him make a difference in your life. Well, my friends, I love you with the love of the Lord. If you would like to contact me for any reason, you can write me at the Word with Chester Ministries, Post Office Box 200483, San Antonio, Texas, 78220. You can also reach me at my website, www.poemsbychester.com. That's P-O-E-M-S by Chester.com. Remember, I love you, my friends. I love you with the love of the Lord. God bless you.